The following program is a PodcastOne.com production.
From Hollywood, California, by way of the Broken Skull Ranch, this is the Steve Austin Show.
Give me a hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
Now, here's Steve Austin.
All right, I've been telling Eric Bischoff about what happened when Fluffy Guy Gabriel Iglesias came over to the house, and I missed an hour and 10 minutes of some of the funniest stuff that's ever been created on the Steve Austin Show. So, what I've done with Eric, we went through a test roll. You probably saw on the timeline, I know you're on Twitter, E. Bischoff, I'm at Steve Austin BSR. You probably saw the cluster muck that happened, and I told you about it when I said, hey, if you want to come down and do the show, you can come down to the house at 316 Gimmick Street, or we can go to Beverly Hills. And I said, I'd just soon rather sit at my house and drink your beer. And you said you was down with that.
Absolutely.
But the bad news of the story was that bad things can happen when you're at my house because of my technology issues. So now that that has been addressed, we have both checked our levels. Welcome to the crib.
Thank you, buddy. Thank you. And there's 2.3 million Stone Cold Steve Austin fans on Twitter that are breathing a sigh of relief right now because we hit the button twice.
We hit the button twice. And, you know, I told you when you were going to come to the show, let's just shoot the breeze because I listen to a lot of the interviews that you do with a lot of the other cats. You know, some of those wrestling insiders, like we, before we hit the record button, we were just kind of talking. Dude, I forgot half of stuff that I did. We were talking about your book. We're going to talk about everything here today about controversy creates cash. But I just figured when you sent out that tweet a while ago, you said, hey, if y'all have any questions for me to ask Steve, send them in. So we'll just go back and forth and shoot the breeze. But the task at hand right now is you came out with the beer back in, what is it, 2010, 2011?
Yeah, I think it was about 2011.
So 2011, Buffalo Bill Cody beer. And I said, hey, man, can you send me a case of your beer to give it a try? And you did. As soon as you walked in the house, I said, hey, man, what do you want to do? I said, you want to, he goes, where's the beer? You got to love a guest. And when he comes to your house and says, where's the beer? I dig that. So anyway, I got a couple chilled out. I got them in some koozies here, fixing to pop the top on this beer and talk about it.
Now, did you get a chance to try them before I got here, or is this the first time?
No, dude, I've been drinking a beer.
Okay, good.
I dig it. Good. Hang on, let's. Here's a toast.
Here's God a toast. Dang,
who would have figured back in the day from when you came in, you know, WCW, as an entry-level announcer, took over the company, fired my ass. Y'all kicked our ass in the Monday Night Wars when you were running WCW. I was starting to get hot at WWF. And then everything happened, come full circle, and we're sitting here drinking a damn beer at my house. If you'd told me in 1995, whenever it was, you fired my ass, I would have said, you're full of crap. But here we are.
Good things are supposed to happen, and here it is.
Here it is. Cheers.
Cheers to you, brother.
Dude, that's a good beer.
That's a damn good beer.
Now, let's talk about this beer. Buffalo Bill Cody beer. Now, what was the inspiration behind this thing?
You know, I've been going up to Cody, Wyoming since I was 22 years old.
Now, how did that happen? Because, man, I read your book. You're from Minnesota. So how'd you end up going to Cody?
It's a long story, and I'll keep it as short as I can. But I had a friend growing up when I was a kid. I lived in Pittsburgh. And he was about 12 years older than I was, 10 years older. And he was kind of a father figure to me because my dad was paralyzed and couldn't do a lot of things with me that he wanted to do, and hunting and fishing and that kind of thing. And his name was Bob Raciopi, lived across the street from me, and he just kind of took me under his wing. And, you know, when you're 14 years old and you got a father-like figure that's 25, 26, that's a big gap in age. But as you get older, 10, 12 years, no big deal. We stayed friends. I used to go out and hunt deer with him in Pennsylvania every Thanksgiving. He had gone out to Wyoming to hunt elk one year. Now, this is when I was about 21. Came back the following year, told me all about it. And I said, man, I had never been out west before. I'd never been west of Minneapolis. Never seen a mountain, never seen elk, never seen anything like that. Just on TV, watching Bonanza.
Right.
And when he came back and he told me about it, I just said, God, I have to do that. So the following year, I went out and met him there during the summer and when I was 22. And I said, someday I got to live here. So I built a house here 20 years later and fell in love with Cody, Wyoming.
So you decided to come out with the beer. Obviously, Buffalo Bill Cody was the guy that he's the one that started the town, right?
Yeah, he founded the town. And being a fan of Cody, Wyoming, and having built a house there back in 97, 98, and become just I'm real familiar with the history of it. And being a fan of beer and a business person or a branding person, I said, damn, why hasn't anybody ever capitalized on this and come up with a Buffalo Bill Cody beer? Because millions of people come through that little town every summer on their way to Yellowstone. I said, I bet you I could sell a 12-pack, a T-shirt, a hat, and a bumper sticker to a good percentage of those people that are coming through this town. And we came out with a beer. It was more of a fun, just vanity project than anything else.
Now, tell me about coming up with a flavor of this beer, because this is good beer. And I'll tell you if it was bad or whatever.
I know you would.
I speak the truth. This is damn good beer. It's easy to drink. And we were talking on the phone. I got into a lot of the IPAs. Man, they sit heavy on you. It's hard to drink them. This is known as a Session L. I started talking about I've been looking about getting in the beer business myself, and I was asking the guy that I was talking to. I said, what exactly is a session beer?
It's like you and I do. It's when you sit down and pound a few.
I know. When the guy was telling me that, I was like, well, see, man, I can make a session beer out of anything. I don't care whether it's 3.5% alcohol or 17.5% alcohol. I can make a session beer out of anything. But basically, it's a beer that's not so filling that you can sit there and drink a bunch of them with your buddies.
Yeah, it's a lighter bodied beer. I wanted a beer that was refreshing. It was crisp. It you could drink more than one or two of them. But also didn't taste like just a big box standard, you know, buy it at any liquor store kind of beer. I wanted it to be special and unique, but not be so heavy that it just, you know, one or two of them and you were done.
Now, how'd you come up with the flavor of this stuff?
I kind of described to our brewer, a gentleman by the name of George Moncure up in Billings, Montana. I sat down with him and just kind of explained to him what I was looking for. And he gave me different samples of different beers that he was already brewing. And I liked a little bit of this one and a little bit of that one and not so much of this one. And we really just sat and combined colors, if you will, on the palate until he came up with the right brew.
Well, see, what I liked about it, I like to normally, when I'm here at the house, I'm a snob. I keep my glass in the freezer. I drink them out of a glass. What I noticed about your beer, it's got good color. A lot of these beers, I mean, this is a pretty light-tasting beer. It's not necessarily classified as a light, but some of those damn things are so damn pale, it just looked like damn piss out of a damn something. It just doesn't have good color. This has great color. Smells good, it looks good, and it tastes good.
It tastes good, and interestingly enough, it tastes a little different out of a tap than it does out of the bottle. And I've never liked tap beer, generally speaking.
Really?
But the tap beer, you know, Buffalo Bill Cody has a little different taste to it, and I actually like it better, but it does have a good, you know, it's kind of a reddish amber color, not, you know, gold or yellow. It's cool beer. Very proud of it.
How long from when you guys started to come up with the flavor and already had a couple and you did your deal, how long did that part of it last? I mean, because, you know, when you start nitpicking in beer, sometimes they all kind of bleed together, start tasting the same. Got to keep them separate. So how long did that process actually take coming up with the final taste once you started tasting?
That was actually pretty easy. I don't think that lasted more than 10 days or 2 weeks at the most.
Right.
It's really easy.
Okay, now you come up with Buffalo Bill Cody beer. You're a pretty smart guy. You went and did some research. You did some trademarking. You come out with your beer. There's another cat down there who came out with the same, well, not the same beer, but another beer called Buffalo Beer. What's it called? Buffalo Bill Beer?
Buffalo Bill Beer, yeah, I believe that was
something it. Along those lines. But he came out 2 days ahead of you. But he hadn't done all the due diligence that you had. So I don't want to necessarily just go into the legalities of it, but is that fight still going on? Because I read the article that you had retweeted a while back. Because it's been a little bit of a pain in the neck for you. Just I know you've done a lot of researching with your trademark stuff, but how big of a pain in the ass is that? And that's kind of a dumb question because any kind of lawsuit or legalities is a pain in the ass.
Yeah, it is, and it was. And we actually made the front page of the Wall Street Journal at one point, you know, that was documenting the litigation. And it was a problem, and it was a problem on a couple different levels. One, it was really expensive, and that always sucks, as you know. Two is the guy that I ended up, you know, or the people that I ended up, you know, having an issue with were originally friends. And you don't want that to happen.
Yeah.
And I can't really speak to too much of the lawsuit because there was a settlement involved. But it took 3 years, way more money than I prefer to even think about.
Right.
And it was very uncomfortable. But it's over. We've got we got the trademark. If you go to USPTO.gov and look up Buffalo Bill Cody Beer, you'll find that, you know, Jason Hervey and I own the trademark.
Right.
And we're marketing the beer.
So is he a partner with you on the
beer? Oh, yeah. Jason's a partner in everything I do.
Everything you do?
Mm-hmm.
And so right now I am on the website, and if you guys want to check out Eric Bischoff's beer, which is damn good beer, I speak to it myself, go to www.BuffaloBillCodyBeer.com, and you can check it out. So y'all in, as we were talking the other day, you're in four states now?
Yeah, we're in Wyoming, Montana, North, South Dakota, and we are working on Colorado and Arizona as we speak.
And then keep trying to just
go
as big as you can?
Nah, you know, yes and no. It's the business has gotten so competitive even within the last 5 or 6 years. It's changed so much that my goal really right now is to get a good solid footprint of distribution in the Rocky Mountain West and in the areas of the country where cowboy culture is kind of predominant, which includes certain markets, you know, it includes Nashville, for example. But I want to get a footprint there and then, you know, look for an exit strategy, quite honestly.
An exit strategy. But, you know, I'm sitting here, I was looking at the bottle the other day, and I saw this little oval. I was like, man, my damn eyes, they used to be. I kind of seen your picture down there. And I was like, man, I got my magnifying glass out there. So when I got the six-pack out here, I can see it right here on the six-pack, your face there in the little oval. It says, an Eric Bischoff family tradition since brewer great-grandfather Robert Bischoff's immigration to the U.S. in 1881. Where'd he come from?
Ancestry.com. And it happened, that information actually came after this whole thing started. And right before we actually started printing the labels, I was just messing around on Ancestry.com because I really didn't know much about my family, to be honest. And I'm digging and digging and digging, and I find out as far back as I could go in my father's side of our family history, my great or great-great-grandfather, whichever one it was, I don't remember now, came to the United States from Germany as a, and his job was a brewer.
Right.
And he moved to Detroit. And that's where our family started here in the U.S. So I went, you know, that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
It's kind of like full circle.
So you got a place in Cody. You live in the Phoenix area. Mm-hmm. You got a place out here in L.A. Now, how are you spending your time between those three locales? Because you, as I talked to you the other day, you're only in Cody because you don't go there in the winter because it's too cold. Are you in the snow skin and all that stuff or what?
No, and there's not a lot of snow around Cody. It's they refer to it as the banana belt of the Rockies because it doesn't get a lot of snow. There's a lot of areas right around it. You know, Jackson Hole is one of the best ski areas in the country, obviously. But it's an hour, hour and a half south. You know, Red Lodge, Montana is 50 minutes north, and it gets a ton of snow. But Cody, because of where it's positioned, doesn't get a lot of snow, but it gets just so much wind. And about November, it goes down to, you know, 15, 20 degrees. Wind picks up to be about 40 miles an hour, and it doesn't slow down until right about now. And the wind just wears you out. So
then you in Phoenix most of the time, just going back and forth between here and L.A.?
My wife and I live in Wyoming from June 1st approximately to, you know, sometime in January. Right. And then we pack up the horses and come down to Arizona and hang out in Arizona till the weather gets nice and Cody, and then go back.
Now, when you say horses, you talking about real horses? Because on your Twitter account, there's a picture of you on a good-looking horse. I forget where you guys are at. Do you own any
horses?
We're
at a bar down the road from where I live. That's exactly where we're at.
But are those your horses? Do you transport them back and forth?
Yeah, I've got 5 horses and a mule.
And you're pulling a trailer with these horses back here.
I don't haul all of them. I haul 3 of them.
Right.
And I've got a mule down in Mule College in Missouri right now. She's coming back from college.
Now, what do they teach a mule in Mule College?
To not kill you. To be good and safe.
But how long? But straight up, I mean, because, man, I grew up, you know, we've been in the cattle business back in the day when I was a kid. Now, we didn't mess around with a whole lot of mules, didn't have any need for one. Y'all use those for pack mules? Y'all riding a little thing or what?
No, this mule, now, I spend most of my time riding horses. I don't ride mules a lot. This is the only mule I have. But she's what they call a gated mule, which means she's got a super smooth ride.
Right.
I mean, you could literally
air suspension almost.
Drink a cup of coffee and ride that mule and not spill a drop.
Right.
So she's a big gated mule, good looking mule, and I'll ride her.
Yeah. You
know, just add her to the garage, so to speak.
Now, where y'all keep your horses once you get into the Phoenix area?
Well, we don't live in Phoenix. We live north of Phoenix, a little town called Cave Creek.
Right.
And it's a western kind of town, a lot of property and horse property. Right. So I keep my horses not on my property, but about 15 minutes away. So I get up every morning and just go and ride and do my thing. And I keep 3 horses in Arizona when my wife and I are there, and I keep the rest of my horses up in Wyoming.
Now, dude, when you're riding in the area you live in Arizona, are you just riding on them little oval tracks? You got a place that you can actually get out in the woods and ride a little bit?
No, well, there's no woods where I live, but there's a lot of cactuses. And where I board my horses is literally on the edge of an area called the Tonto National Forest. And you could literally ride from 2 minutes from where I could literally ride out the property and keep riding north until I get to probably Utah if I wanted to.
Right.
And it's all forest. So it's amazing trails. Absolutely beautiful.
Now, when I saw your picture on Twitter, you was out there in a pair of jeans and kicking it. Now, you don't put that equestrian garb on there and put your helmet on, do you?
Just in my private life.
I'm taking that as a no.
My wife likes those fancy boots.
That's okay if your wife does. But are you in all the jumping stuff? You just ride?
No, just simply trail riding.
But did you ride horses when you was a kid?
No, I really just got into horses about 6 years ago, 7 years ago. And I leased a couple because I'd never owned one before. Right. And I didn't know anything about it. I didn't even know how to put a saddle on a horse.
I didn't know you could lease a horse.
Yeah, well, up in Wyoming you can, but I didn't even know how to saddle one. I didn't. I used to watch people put a saddle on a horse and go, God, how do they remember how to do all this? That's tricky stuff. I could fly an airplane, had my instrument rating, but I couldn't saddle a horse.
Yeah.
And then I just started learning a little bit at a time. And I took some lessons from guys that really knew what they were doing, you know, Western riders and cowboys, and, you know, got comfortable enough and that's it. You know?
But, yeah, it was funny because, you know, like in hearing you do all this stuff in Cody, and don't mean this as disrespect, but I always figured because, man, when you showed up, because I used to watch you way back in the day in AWA, good looking cat on the stick, doing the announcing, come to WCW and took over the company. But I was, you know, thinking, you know, straight up city slicker. And all of a sudden, man, I see y'all Western getting out there in the woods because you like to do a lot of hunting too.
Well, that, you know, I started hunting when I was a kid,
right,
you know, with my dad, and continued as I got older with friends and the gentleman that I talked to you about. So hunting has always been a big part of my life. Doing things outdoors.
Hunting what? What are y'all hunting?
Started out when I was a kid, man, I was hunting pheasants and rabbits.
Right.
You know, squirrels occasionally. As I got older, you know, I got into deer hunting, obviously, and did a lot of deer hunting in Pennsylvania, where it was quite popular. And then when I could, and I moved out west, my son and I went elk hunting with muzzle loaders last year in New Mexico.
So y'all are going, doing the whole, old school.
That was a whole different deal with a muzzle loader. But, you know, I've packed up into the wilderness on horseback, you know, 10 or 12 horses and pitched tents and hunted elk for, you know, days at a time. And I love it.
If you was going to grab your number one gun, what gun is that? For elk hunting.
300 Weatherby.
300 Weatherby.
Yep, 150 grain.
What scope?
I think I've got a Nikon 3-14 on that one because I got a really bad right eye, so I need a good magnification.
You ever think about, I've got a place down here in South Texas. I've had it for about 8 years. Of course, I've been doing the hunting thing my whole entire life and doing the gun thing. And down there where I'm at, it's a little bit different than where you're at. You know, we're high-fenced, so we're controlling our population. You know, trying to grow big deer, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they're wild. We're not pen-raising anything. They're natives, South Texas. They were there when I bought the ranch. We're just trying to grow them big. But now I'm looking into getting into the archery thing. Has that bug bitten you yet?
It did when I lived in Minnesota about 30 years ago. I got into it real heavy, and it left. Because there's a lot of work. It's a different deal. And honestly, the reason I lost interest in it, quite frankly, is because it happens in the early part of the season when it's hot. And there were still mosquitoes and bugs and crap out there. And to me, you know, I don't want to freeze my ass off, but I don't want to be sweating, you know, like I'm digging a ditch either.
Yeah.
And it didn't work for me.
Yeah. Man, that's one of the things down here in South Texas. Our season actually starts, we're what's known as MLD, level 3, which we can start our hunting season a little bit before the normal season happens. But it's so damn hot, you know, and in South Texas, you know where, how you guys are hunting out there, but basically you're stand hunting. You know, we're in the brush country. Everything is so thick down there, the vegetation and everything that grows will cut you, stick you, hurt you. It's a brush country. And so just walking around prowling ain't going to get you a big deer. You're just going to get a bunch of thorns in your ass. But sitting in them boxes, man, sometimes, you know, get down there in the early part of deer season, you know, it's close to 100 degrees. You know, it's like a scene out of Cool Hand Luke when they put him in a box. Hey, ain't my idea having a good time,
right.
You know? So half times I'm sitting in the shorts I'm wearing right now without a shirt on and a pair of flip-flops. You know, if I shoot something, I'll just take my Polaris over there and pick a damn thing up, put it in the back and go. But it's just too damn hot. But that's one of the things that I wanted to do. I want to check into a little bit of the black powder stuff that you're doing. But this year, I think me and my buddy are going to start doing a little bit of bow hunting and trying to get up close. We video everything we see over there so we can – it's always funny when you go out there and someone says to you, hey, man, did you see anything? Oh, yeah. God dang it, I saw a 10-point. He was this big, and they put their hands out like this. And when you really see that deer,
sure,
he's probably a lot smaller. So we video everything. But I'm looking forward to starting the bow – to getting into the bow thing and – if I could just beat the heat.
Have you ever thought about bow hunting for elk?
Well, you know, I want to start off with some pigs at the ranch, and then I want to graduate to some of my deer. Start off with my does, and then get into my bucks. But yeah, I'd like to get to where I can hunt everything. But going up back to almost the point you were about to make a while ago, is other than sweating your ass off in the early part of the season, our schedules, the lives that we were leading back in the day, people would say, "Hey, man, you know, I was traveling all over the world. We was on the road probably, you know, 300 days a year. Do you bow hunt?" "No, man, why not?" "Well, I got a better chance of shooting something 300 yards on end, whether I do 30 yards on end." You know what I'm saying? So, but one of these days, yeah.
The cool thing about elk, and I've never done it, by the way, so I'm not speaking from experience, but I have a lot of friends that do. And the cool thing is, especially up, you know, where I live in Wyoming, when you hunt with a bow for elk, you're right in the middle of the rut. And you can call them in, like ducks and geese. Mm-hmm. And I have called in or been with someone, a guide, who called an elk into me once up in British Columbia. And there is nothing more exhilarating in your life than to have some guy calling an elk from probably a mile and a half away when you first start hearing it, and you get it within 30, 40 yards of you, and it is pissed off, and it's big, and it's tearing stuff up.
Yeah.
That is exciting stuff.
I got a buddy, well, my brother-in-law, who's a professional guide over in Sparks, Nevada. That's what he does, and he's outstanding at it, and they're hunting big country over there. So I've been trying to get out there and hunt with him. And, man, I'm 49 years old. I took my hunter safety course probably when I was 13 years old in Texas. You got to have a hunter safety course certificate when you go to Nevada to hunt. And I've been meaning to – I can't find a damn thing. I don't know if I can get it go back in the records and find a damn thing. But I've been meaning to take that stupid-ass course so my old ass could go to Nevada with my brother-in-law and try to hunt an elk. It's a pain in the ass.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. They make it tough.
Hey, man, not to get too much into politics, but you're obviously a pro-gun guy, right?
Definitely. I had to remember to take one out of my bag before I got on the plane.
What was it?
I have a Sig Sauer 9mm
right.
that I carry, and then I've got...
UCCW?
Yeah.
Oh, how long have you been?
Arizona, Wyoming. And by the way, in either state you need one anymore. You can carry one as long as you're not a felon in either state.
Right.
But I have them anyway because it's easier to buy one over the counter if you've got a permit.
Right.
But I've had my permits for, I don't know, 15 years. I had a permit in Georgia before I left Atlanta back in whenever it was.
Now, you're probably in a neighborhood in Arizona, but out there in Cody, are you on some property? You on some land?
Yeah, quite a bit.
Do you have a gun range you can shoot at? I mean, can you shoot on
the
property?
Shoot out the front porch.
So how often do you like to – see, because that's one of the things I like to do. See, a lot of these people, you see them, you know, carrying or whatever, and one thing makes me nervous, see a guy carrying cocked and locked, and you're like, okay, what's the mental status of this cat? Is he proficient with this weapon? I like to shoot. Do you get a chance to practice?
I shoot. You know, I actually take my nephew shooting. He just started getting interested within the last year. So I take him out. I take my wife shooting. You know, she's proficient. Yeah, she hunts with me. I mean, she's been hunting with me for 30 years.
Right.
So... I shoot fairly regularly because you got to shoot fairly often to stay decent.
Yeah, I love it first, but if you're gonna carry, you got to be good with what you're doing. You got to be safe with what you're doing. You were talking about your instrument rating a while ago. When did you get your pilot license?
Think about 1998.
Dude, man, I've been thinking about wanting to fly for a long time. My wife bought me one of them Groupons. I'd never thought in a million years I'd be sitting there talking about a podcast talking about a Groupon. That's the latest, greatest thing. For a flight lesson out of Santa Monica Airport, because I've been thinking about learning how to fly a plane. But then we flew my ranch this year for an aerial survey, so we did it on a helicopter, R-44, four-person helicopter. Same guy I've been flying with for a couple of years, and the guy's just, he's been doing it his whole life. He's really good at it. And he goes, "Steve, I could teach an idiot to fly. I could teach you too." But here's the thing, you know, the maintenance on a helicopter, you know, what are you really going to do with it once you get it? So kind of threw that out the window. Question I'm asking you, as far as learning how to fly an airplane, how was it? I mean, how long did it take you? Well, how was the protocol?
It, you know, I started taking flying lessons because, believe it or not, I kept having the same reoccurring nightmare over and over.
What was that?
Of being on an approach in a small plane and getting tangled up in power lines.
Right.
And I started having that dream when I was a little kid. And I kept having it throughout my life. And it was, you know, it's not like I had it once a week or so, but a couple times a year, I'd have that same damn dream. And I said to myself one day, I said, you know, this is stupid. I've got to learn how to fly for no other reason than to quit. I wasn't afraid to fly, but I just kept having that damn dream. So I took my first flying lesson. And I went, son of a man, that's fun. And I started flying and it took me, you know, I don't remember how long. It probably took me 4, 5, 6 months to get my pilot's license, and then I immediately started my instrument. In fact, I bought a plane here in John Wayne Airport, Santa Monica. It was classified as a high-performance plane, meaning it had a retractable gear and a turbocharged engine and all that, which was a higher rating. So I immediately started taking lessons with the guy that I bought the plane from and started working on my instrument rating like 2 days after I got my pilot's license. And I got my instrument rating about 6 months after that.
Do you still have the airplane?
No, I sold it about 6 years ago.
Now, why'd you sell it? You weren't using it enough?
Yeah, you know what I found is, it's a funny thing. It's like when you have enough time, you don't have enough money. And when you have enough money, you don't have enough time.
Right.
And I started getting to the point where I had to get busy again because I lost my ass in the real estate market and a bunch of other bad stuff happened, like a lot of people. And I just didn't have the time. And what happens with a plane, especially a high-performance plane, is you start – if you don't fly that thing at least 3 or 4 times a week, you're not safe.
Right.
And then you start making excuses not to fly because deep down inside you know you probably shouldn't.
Right.
I wouldn't let my wife and kids fly with me anymore. And it's longer periods of time went on between the time I flew. And I went, you know what? It's a big hole to feed every single week because it is expensive. And I knew deep down inside I was done, so I just got rid of it.
So how hard was it to flip it?
Actually, I made money on the plane.
Yeah.
Planes are a little different. You know, you can, if as long as you take care of them, they don't depreciate much. I did okay.
But now that you know how to fly, you got your instrument rating.
Mm-hmm.
Now, man, with our jobs, what we used to do, fly a hell of a lot. So are there ever any times when you're going somewhere and all of a sudden, based on what the plane's doing, you're thinking, hey, man, something ain't copacetic here.
Sure. Sure.
Does that bother you even more?
No,
because you know what's going on.
No, it might bother the person who's happened to be sitting next to me because I'm talking to myself going, oh, this son of a bitch just missed his approach. There was a plane down here and nobody saw it until the last minute, which is why we're doing a wheelie around again. So the person next to me is kind of panicking. But, you know, I've got a lot of faith in commercial pilots and you know, I'd rather do that than drive through Los Angeles.
Man, there's some bad drivers down there. No
kidding.
You ever drive through El Paso, your hair will be whiter than it is already. Hey, man, since we're talking about being in the air, what are your thoughts on, Flight 370 over Malaysia?
It's just such an abstract thought. You know, my biggest question is how a plane, you know, if you look at the flight path of that plane, it probably took off doing about, you know, 10, 15 degrees to the north, just a little bit to the right. And then all of a sudden, it did, you know, an 80-degree turn or 120-degree turn to the left. Why would that happen?
Right.
And no communication, no warning, nothing. That's too bizarre.
Right.
Beyond that, no explanation at all. I have no idea what happened, but I can't imagine it happening.
Well, I can't believe they can't find
It's a big ocean, man. And when a plane hits, it's not like people imagine, you know, when they see movies, a plane hits the water and it stays intact and it floats. You know, you hit the water from that altitude, it's no different than hitting the parking lot at a Walmart.
Right, right, right.
This stuff just shatters. So it's really not surprising.
Not surprising. I'm going to go to the freezer, grab another Buffalo Bill Cody beer. I'm sitting here drinking with Eric Bischoff.
This is the Steve Austin Show.
Paying out of your own pocket for gear you need to do your job is a problem. All kinds of departments across the nation, police, fire, EMS, medical workers on the front lines, and even military units, they all deal with constrained budgets and outdated gear. But there's still a job to do, and you need the gear to do it. Hunting for military first responder discounts has historically required going from one website to another and all kinds of hassle. Don't you wish there was one place you could visit that had a carefully crafted selection of deals for military first responders in one spot? GovX works directly with brands to negotiate the best prices possible because you deserve the gear you need at the prices you've earned. Plus, you can trust that the gear you're ordering is 100% authentic, direct from the manufacturer. If you must pay out of your own pocket, you shouldn't have to pay a premium to get the gear you need to effectively perform your duties and complete your mission. GovX has a huge collection of gear and apparel from popular brands, all in one convenient location. It's like a grown man's toy store in here. Just wait until you see our knife collection. All you need to do is sign up for free. No subscription fees. No re-upping your membership every year. Once you're approved, you're a fully fledged GovX member for life. GovX honors your service and gives back to your communities. We don't just thank you for your service, we honor it. So if you're an American of service, a current or former member of the military, firefighting, frontline medical, or law enforcement communities, or the emergency medical, join GovX for free and enjoy a community that honors and gives back to patriots like you. If you've got a military or first responder background, visit GovX.com and sign up for free for instant access to tons of deals and a community that honors your service. Visit GovX.com and receive $15 off first orders over $50 or more when you use code STEVE. That's $15 off first orders over $50 or more when you use code STEVE at GovX.com. Just opened up another beer sitting here with Eric Bischoff. We was going to talk about pro wrestling, but we'll get there in a minute. Let's talk about reality television. Because you and your partner, Jason Hervey, and BHETV.
BHETV.
Man, I know I had my facts straight. I had to make sure I got that straight. BHETV. What are you guys working on right now?
We've got a couple projects that we're working on right now. Jason's especially involved right now. Of course, Discovery. We had Devil's Ride.
Right.
We're hoping that we're going to get a season 4 out of that. That's a big show for us and has been. We've got a Nickelodeon show with Scott Baio, a sitcom that we're just wrapping up. We've got a VH1 show that's going to start here in July that's going to air soon. There'll be a big press release about that. I have to let them talk about that.
Right, right.
That show's going to start pretty soon. And we've got four or five other really cool projects that are at various stages of development, some about ready, some just beginning to cook. That we're doing. So it's something we've been doing since 2003.
Now, see, man, I fell into the reality television game when WWE contacted me about, hosting a show for them called Tough Enough, trying to find the next WWE superstar. At least that was the task at hand back in the day. And the show kicked ass, didn't get picked up for another season. And it was kind of, reincarnated, when myself and Bill DeMott, Trish Stratus, and Booker T took it over. And had a blast making it. And that's when I fell in love with it because I had a lot of opportunities to do some reality television, which wasn't so great when I first came out here. But my first foray into it, I fell in love with it. And I've been able to, host a show for CMT called Redneck Island. We just filmed a show called Broken Skull Challenge, a heavy-duty competition show, which is going to start airing July 6th for CMT, and had a blast making that. How did you fall into or get into the reality television business?
Well, again, it started back in 2003, and, Jason and I were both, we made a decision.
Where did y'all meet at, you and Jason? Because y'all been buddies
really
a long
in WCW.
Time.
I've known Jason since he was 17 years old. He was still on the Wonder Years when I first met Jason.
What were you doing at that time?
I was in WCW. I was actually running a good chunk of WCW.
Where did you guys come across each other?
Well, he was a friend with somebody in WCW.
Gotcha.
And they ended up not staying friends any longer, but Jason and I, we remained friends. I actually pitched him a show back then when I was just a C-Squad announcer working under Tony Schiavone and Jim Ross. And he loved the idea, and he had the relationships in Hollywood. And we came out here and pitched it, sold it to Fox back when Fox had a kids network. Show never got made, but they bought it. They optioned it, and we felt like, we hit a home run or at least a base hit. And for a long time, we kept going back and forth and trying different things together. And I brought him into WCW to do a lot of things. He did a big, home video deal with Time Warner and Warner Video. We'd made a couple TV movies together at Turner. So we'd constantly been doing things together ever since I've known him. But back in 2003, we said, it's kind of silly. We've been building businesses and creating ideas for other people. Let's do it for ourselves.
Right.
And that's when we started.
Now, Jason's parents come up in the business, second-generation guy. What do his parents do?
Well, his entire family, one side of the business or the other, mostly on the business side,
right,
have been in the entertainment business, either as agents, lawyers, managers. His uncle is the business manager or has been the business manager, take your pick, for some of the biggest A-list names that have ever lived in Hollywood and still is. So Jason's been around the entertainment business, both sides of it, for a long time.
So, obviously the guy has absorbed a lot of information and is a smart guy to begin with. So he's got a lot of business savvy.
He's amazing, really. He's, you know, I jokingly refer to him as a Wolverine because he is. He's right. Just, you know, this, he's an animal. He's relentless. Once he gets his mind set on something, he doesn't let it go. And he is incredibly smart. He does have, his Rolodex is ridiculous. I mean, it's walking around Hollywood with him is ridiculous. Not because of the Wonder Years or his on-camera stuff, but because of his, you know, the business
relationships,
side.
Yep. You know, through his family and his work. So when it comes down to the reality television stuff, man, what is your, I mean, if you guys are structuring the deals or whatever that is, are you in on the creative level? Are you the big picture level? Hey, here's a concept. Now let's hone it down and finesse it to something specific. What's your strong suit in regards to BHE TV?
We come up with a lot of the concepts. We start on, you know, in some cases it's been on the back of a bar napkin after 12 beers.
Right.
And, hey, I had an idea. Let's try this. Right. And develop that idea out. We've had people bring us ideas because we've now developed a little bit of a track record. And there are people that have great ideas and great relationships out there but don't really know how to pull it off.
Right.
So they'll bring us ideas. There's a combination of the two. So there's no one way we do things. But there's been a number of shows that we start, like I said, on the back of a bar napkin, and we see it all the way through. We not only come up with a big idea, we pitch it through. We actually do the physical production, and we have an office over in Burbank with, you know, probably 25 editors and Avids and Unities and a pretty big staff that can run anywhere from, you know, 3, 4, 5 shows simultaneously.
So, man, how you enjoying what you do now compared with what you were doing back in the day when we were involved in right in the thick of the Monday Night Wars? I mean, for me, I always tell people, man, you know, that was like a high point or a highlight of my life. And now it's fond memories, and I don't just harbor for them, but, I mean, I just want to live on them. I've moved on. But, I mean, like now from just a day-to-day thing of going to the next project, is there that equal high now in your business life?
I wouldn't say it's equal, but it's different. It's not better. It's not worse. It's just different. You know, it's a little bit like saying
making,
you know,
a dollar
when you're 19. It's not even about that because there's still the creative challenge. Mm-hmm. There's the, you know, let's recreate the wheel a little differently. Let's come up with the next big idea. That's still a big part of who I am and always will be. Has been since as long as I can remember. But it just takes a different shape now and a different energy now. It's a little bit like me saying to you, you know, Steve, you know, what got you most excited when you were 19 years old? It was probably a lot different when you were 19 than it is now. It doesn't mean you can't still get excited about something, right, whether it's hunting or whatever it is, but it takes on a different shape and form.
Agreed.
It's the same thing here. Back in WCW, when I got thrust into that situation and I was full of myself and I had all the confidence in the world, I knew I had some support behind me, I just wanted to fight. You know, if it was a choice between having great sex and a good fight, 7 or 8 times out of 10, I'd just get bloody, you know, because that's just the way it was.
He said that.
It's a little different now.
I got to get the lowdown on it because you said those very words in your book, Controversy Creates Cash. You're a guy who'd rather fight than have sex.
I said it differently in the book.
Yeah, well, and we're on a family-friendly show, so I'll stick with that.
The Steve Austin Show. The Steve Austin Show.
Hey man, do you own or rent your home? Sure you do. And I bet it can be hard work. You know what's easy? Bundling policies with GEICO. GEICO makes it easy to bundle your homeowner's or renter's insurance along with your auto policy. It's a good thing, too, because you already have so much to do around your home. Go to GEICO.com, get a quote, and see how much you could save. It's GEICO easy. Visit GEICO.com today. That's GEICO.com. But still that way.
Not so much. Yeah. But it takes a different shape now.
Right.
I tend to be more thoughtful about it, right, and strategic and don't really want to go through the scar tissue. Before it was like, yeah, screw it. Well, let's see what happens.
Yeah.
Whatever. We'll learn. We'll come out of it fine. Now I'd rather avoid as many issues as I can and still get to the same point.
Right. Man, I remember back in the day when I used to see on an AWA, then you came into WCW, I said, man, that dude looks just like a damn model. I was reading your book. You used to be a model.
Imagine that.
And dude, you know, I'm sitting right across the table from a guy, straight, you're a good-looking guy.
Used to be.
So, yeah, it used to be. So, dude, tell me about the modeling career. How was that? Did you dig it? I mean, or was it a means to an end, or did you really enjoy it?
No, I didn't really.
Take advantage of your genetics?
I needed the money. And it was like, you know, back then, I think I started, I don't know what it was. God, it must have been 78, 79. And people were paying me like 80, 90 bucks an hour. Well, back in 1978, 79, 80 or 90 bucks an hour was a fair amount of money. And I thought, well, this is pretty damn cool. I'll do it. Didn't bother me, you know. And it was always that, you know, it was that upside. God, what if, you know, what if I go to Chicago and I, you know, go to New York, do this big thing? It could be huge. Because there was that, you know, there was that big golden carrot there. But it was fun. You know, I met my wife.
But how did you get discovered in the modeling industry? Because, man, dude, when you were, did you start the landscaping company in Minnesota?
I mean, that was a long time before.
But you hit big in the landscaping business, and you were very successful, but you decided to get out of it. And so how did you get discovered, if I can use that term, in the modeling career?
I had a...
Because it wasn't an objective, was
no,
it?
No. I had a friend.
Every time you say friend, you do this little look.
I had a friend
yeah.
who had some friends that were photographers. And thought, oh, my God, this guy, he'd be a great model. You know, let's just do some test shots.
Yeah.
What the hell? It's not going to cost me anything. We'll do it. And they did it. They submitted him to an agency. And the agency went, holy crap. We need to find out who this guy is. Let's represent him. And they started representing me. And, you know, 3 days later, I was getting paid 80 or 90 bucks an hour to have my picture taken.
So how long did that last?
A couple of years. I met my wife, my current wife, you know, doing that. She and I moved to Chicago together. She was a model. We moved to Chicago back when I don't think she was 21, 22 years old at the time. We moved to Chicago and ended up, you know, she got pregnant and we had Garrett and we got married shortly thereafter. We've been together ever since. So it was great.
As I segue into the trash truck coming to pick up my final trash can on the streets of Los Angeles, California. Now, if we was on a reality television set or a movie set, we would say, hold for garbage truck. Normally, that's reserved for hold for airplane, because every time you're trying to film something out in the middle of nowhere, an airplane will buzz over, and you can't hear a damn thing. So we are holding actively for the garbage truck, picking up all the garbage that I put in that sunbuck this week.
I hear a lot of cans rolling around out there.
That was in the recycle bin earlier today. What you're hearing is pure trash. So the modeling gig runs. It goes dry.
Yeah, I did it for a while. My current wife and I, we moved to Chicago. You know, Garrett, she got pregnant with Garrett. We had Garrett and figured out, okay, I got to go get a real job. I moved to a small town in north central Minnesota called Bram, Minnesota. Was working for a company that manufactured and sold potato harvesting equipment, of all damn things. And that was about miserable. It was good deer hunting up there. That's the only thing that got me through it. And we lived right next door to a bar and a pizza joint, so that was okay. But that lasted for a little while. Moved back to Minneapolis and worked for a food processing company, selling meat door to door, so to speak. Not figuratively, literally, but figuratively. And that's shortly after that is when I broke into wrestling.
So you went to Vern. You got in and you were selling advertising?
Yeah. When I pitched Vern and a group of people worked for Vern. I pitched him an idea for a silly little game that a friend of mine and I developed.
Sonny Ono.
Yeah. We came up with this little game, spent a ton of money, you know, having it manufactured over Korea, shipped to like 12 train car fulls of them back to the U.S., didn't have anywhere to put them and didn't know how the hell we were going to sell them. So I went and pitched him to Vern. Said, hey, why don't we, because he had a show on ESPN Monday through Friday in the afternoon. So why don't we'll sell these together, you know, 1-800, sell this game, and we'll split the profit. They said, sure, let's give it a whirl. And it didn't work, but Vern liked me, and the company, you know, Mike Shields, who was, you know, a big part of what was going on there, saw something in me. What, I don't know, but he did. And they just said, look, we need some help in syndication, which is essentially selling the show to individual markets around the country. Why don't you do that? You're really good at selling. So.
And you had met Vern way back in the day when you were on a wrestling team and was trying to get some pub for one of the tournaments y'all going to have, right?
Yeah, I used to wrestle.
Did he remember you?
No.
Right.
No.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, I used to wrestle in high school, and I was on an AU freestyle Greco-Roman wrestling team.
You still got those skills?
No. I wrestle my shoes onto my feet every morning. But, you know, back then, right, when I was, you know, 19 years old, and I said, okay, we got to raise some money for this. You know, Vern Gagne, he supports amateur wrestling. Right. So I went and was on his show, you know, Wally Carbo. And you
know, I loved watching that guy, just watching the footage from back in the day, watching Wally Carbo do his thing.
Was he Marty O'Neill. And I got interviewed by Marty O'Neill. Yeah. It was great.
Man, I was reading through your Twitter profile. Lee Marshall died a while back.
Yeah, I think it was last week.
Yeah, what happened to Lee?
You know, I don't know the details. I don't know. But Lee was a great guy.
Yeah, I mean, I loved watching him on TV.
Yeah, we brought him to, you know, I brought him into WCW. He did some stuff for us on Nitro, did the Road Report. And he had an amazing voice.
He had
a real passion for the wrestling business. And he knew everybody on the West Coast. He was very, very well entrenched in the wrestling world here.
Man, when you busted in there with Vern and you're selling syndication. But he kept everything on a down low. I mean, he was kayfabe. What happened in the ring, or as far as pertaining to the ring and booking, all that strategy was totally kept away from you guys, right?
Steve, even to the point after I had been there for a year or so, when we would do an interview, and I'm the sick man at that time, and he'd give me the look, which was my cue to step out the door. Yeah. And then he'd go over the promo with the talent, and he'd give me the look, and it was okay for me to come back in. And that was the way I was brought up. And I've carried that with me ever since.
Right. You obviously learned a lot with that guy as far as, you know, selling syndication, going through everything that you'd go through, and your rise to WCW. But what would you think in your whole tenure with Vern was the most important thing you learned from that guy?
Respect for the business. To respect the art of the business and the mystique of the business to this day. That's the thing that I think is mostly lacking. Occasionally, you know, you get a story.
Lacking in what regard?
In every regard. For me, and I know I watch wrestling differently than, you know, the average person, as I'm sure you do. But there are moments when what I see in the ring or what I hear allows me to forget that I'm watching wrestling, and I just believe the character, and I believe the story.
Right.
The minute you allow me to drop my hands and stick my chin out and believe what you're doing, you got me.
Right.
But when you're constantly, not you, but when one is constantly doing things that remind me that it's not real and that it doesn't make any real sense, I feel kind of stupid.
Right.
So I crave those moments when it's believable and it's real. I crave them. And that is a result of an understanding and a respect for the art form, whether it's acting, singing, dancing. If you can't create the feeling so that the audience feels it with you, you're just going through the motions.
All right. We're going to come back to that. But let's go back to you starting behind the stick. Because you never had no intention of picking a stick. And when I tell my people, my listeners, a stick, I'm talking about a mic. And all of a sudden, you're doing the backstage interviews, and you're an on-air personality almost overnight.
A real bad
one. You said you were pretty bad. You're very honest and very candid in your book. You said you were pretty bad. You were brutal, and the guys would rib you and give you a hard time. But so how was that process? Did Vern help you gain some confidence? Was it going through the motions? Is it that repetition, which is seemingly the key to anything in life and on-the-job training, working with the veterans?
Looking back at it now, what I really think, and I don't think Vern planned it this way, but what he did, the way he kept me away from the inside, the way he kept me away from the mechanics of it all, forced me to react naturally. I didn't anticipate what someone was going to say because I didn't know what they were going to say. I wasn't thinking ahead of people. I wasn't pretending how I was going to react to something. I just had to react to it, which is really what acting should be.
Right.
It's not acting, it's reacting. And like I said, he didn't plan it that way, but that's the way it worked out.
So how long would you figure in a timeline would when you started you know, doing the broadcasting stuff, doing interviews, give yourself a passing grade?
I was never really good as an announcer. I was adequate as an announcer. I think when I was doing Nitro, I was functional. I could tell the story. I could check all the boxes. I could do a decent job. But I would say I was always kind of a C or a C+. Every once in a while a B. when I got into Nitro, because that was, that became me.
Right.
That animal, I became that animal became me. That changed things up a little bit. And I got pretty decent then.
No, I thought you were really good at it because, I mean, you knew which,
you, I you felt
knew
it.
Every single thing that was going to go down. It was, you know, a big part of your vision, and you were going out there and just spewing forth and venting and speaking from the heart. But you knew you had all the cards in the deck, but also you had that swagger and that confidence, and you had a ton of steam. Took a while to get that, but once you stepped into that role, I thought you did A-plus on that spot.
I think more than knowing everything was going on, I was able to feel everything was going on.
Dude,
much differently.
You got to feel it. Whether you're talking about it, you're in the ring doing it, you got to feel the business of pro wrestling. I agree with that. What happened on the tryout gig with WWF back in the day? you come out of AWA, you've been doing that for, what, a year or two? And then say, hey, man, I want to make a step up. Did you? And Vince Jr. had already bought the business, right, from his dad?
Yep. What happened is Vern, you know, I've been working with Vern for a couple of years. He was going out of business.
Right.
It was obvious.
So writing was on the wall.
I hadn't gotten – I was, you know, they were hauling the trucks or cars out of my driveway. I was – you know, late on my mortgage payments.
The times were tough.
It was ugly tough.
Yeah.
And I knew I had to leave, and I didn't want to because I really loved, and to this day, love Vern Gagne and respect what he did for me. But I had to. And I went to Vern and said, I'm sorry, brother. I didn't call him brother, but I said, sorry, Vern, I have to do this. And he understood. Mm-hmm. I went with permission and respect. And I went because I saw they were auditioning. I think I saw an ad in the paper back then. And they knew who I was or figured it out, flew me out to New York, went to the studios, put me in front of a green screen. I think somebody said, here's a broom. Interview the broom. Cool. At that point, I would have eaten the broom.
Yeah.
You know, and crapped it out on the studio floor if they asked me to because I needed the gig.
Yeah.
But, you know, I sucked.
Yeah.
And they saw it.
Yeah.
And everybody was nice, and it was a fun experience. And I was disappointed I didn't get it. For obvious reasons, but wasn't meant to be.
So then back to AWA, and then how'd you get the call from WCW?
It was back to AWA, and then probably within 2 or 3 months from that, then I got a call from Turner. It was them reaching out to me, not me.
And that's the way you
them.
Always wanted to be in the wrestling business. I may be seemingly in everything you do in life, but I'm pretty much from the wrestling business, so you always want them calling you.
They called me, and I remember it like it was an hour ago. My wife and I are in bed. It was in the morning. We had a mattress that was on the floor because we couldn't afford a box spring. There was no other furniture. I think a TV and a cardboard box. And financially dying. But I got that phone call, and I sat at the edge of the bed. I went, I probably jumped and screamed like a 12-year-old kid. It was so awesome. And I flew down to Atlanta a couple days later and got the gig.
So how was going down there? Because, man, what year was that?
Would have been 91, maybe.
Man, 1991. I was already in the company because I remember when you rode.
No, you were there.
Yeah, I damn sure was there. And we're going to continue this conversation. Eric Bischoff makes the leap from AWA into WCW, where I had been for about 6 months to a year, still about 3 years in the business, a hell of a technician in the ring. But that's another story for another day.
This is the Steve Austin Show.
Support for this podcast comes from Pluto TV. Need an escape? Drop into Pluto TV for a world of free TV. Stream hundreds of channels and thousands of movies and shows all for free. Yeah, free. No subscriptions, no fees. Imagine 24/7 channels of Narcos, CSI, Star Trek, Survivor, and everything else from hit movies to binge-worthy TV shows, the latest news, live sports, comedy, and more. What are you waiting for? Download the free Pluto TV app for Android, iPhone, Roku, and Fire TV and start streaming now. Pluto TV. Drop in, watch free.
All right, I'm sitting there shooting the breeze here at 316 Gimmick Street with Eric Bischoff. He's over here at the crib. We're talking about his days. He just rolled into WCW. He needed a job bad. Mattress on the floor, no other furniture in the house. So your wife, boy, she's a real trooper.
She's awesome to this day.
Through thick and thin.
To this day. She's toughest person I know.
Yeah, you mentioned her in the book, and you guys have been through a lot together. So, man, you guys are happy in the clan. Come down to the ATL Atlanta, and Jim Ross is the number one announcer,
mm-hmm.
and then Tony Schiavone.
Yep.
And then you.
Yeah, me and probably three or four other people.
Okay. So when you came in, did they welcome you with open arms?
No.
How is it? I mean, because that's got to be just as competitive as the guys in the squared circle.
Even more so. Okay. Because when they brought me down for the tryout, and I'll spend a couple minutes on that, brought me down, and there was a whole, you know, backstory with Diamond Dallas Page, and I know you're friends with DDP.
Yeah.
There was a whole backstory between him and I at AWA, which wasn't great. But I got down there. And they said, okay, here's what you're going to do today. We're going to pair you up with Diamond Dallas Page as your color guy. And the last time I remember seeing Diamond Dallas Page is he and I were in a parking lot and it was about to get ugly. And I thought, oh, this is great. He's working here. I'm needing this gig bad. And the last time we laid eyes on each other, it was just going to get ass ugly. So I thought, oh, what could be worse? And to his credit, and there's, you know, people say what they want about him, but he's got a heart as big as a mountain.
Absolutely.
And he'll give you anything.
100%.
And he pulled me aside. He goes, look, brother, this is what you need to do. This is what they're looking for. Let me help you through this. And he really worked hard to help me through it because he knew what they were looking for, and I didn't.
Right.
So he did, and I did the demo tape, and then they sent the demo tape up to Jim Herd. And an hour later, he called me up to his office, and I don't remember his voice enough to do a good imitation, but he looked at me and said, here's what we're going to do. See this guy right here? He pointed to Jim Ross. This guy, they're a pain in the ass. We're going to put some pressure on them. So your job is to make them miserable. Great. Cool. I can do that.
No. Well, what he means, he wants you to put pressure on them and make their life miserable.
Professionally. He wants me to be competitive.
Right.
That's what he was saying.
Okay.
And that's the way I took it.
Right.
It's not what I wanted to. I didn't want to come into a hostile environment, but I didn't really care either.
Right.
I needed the gig.
Coming into that audition with Paige, and he says, hey, brother, here's what they want, and this is what they're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
How far, if you can remember back then, how far away was that where you were thinking they wanted you to go? I mean, just because coming in with the mindset that you were coming to lay down from what you were doing in AWA, how far off the mark would you have been?
I don't know. You know, honestly, I don't know. But I know, I remember what he told me made sense. It felt right. I knew that I had to depend. It was a dance. I wasn't out there doing a solo. You know, it was a dance. And if this is what he felt he needed, he wanted to play off me, I needed to play off him. Right. And he had an instinct for it. I was willing to take the risk. And I did, and it worked.
So you get there, and then Jim Ross, Tony Schiavone, Lead Dogs. Man, did these guys go out of their way to say, hey, kid, or Eric, I got some advice for you, or check this out. Maybe I ought to try this. How forthcoming were they with dropping a little information on you as far as, you know, regards to helping your announced style?
Schiavone, not at all. Schiavone was more, and I don't think it was a reflection of how he felt about me, but he was very much a mechanic. Right. He was just a get the job done, check the box, move on to the next one. He was a good foreman.
Right.
You know what I mean? He didn't share anything. And Jim had a little bit more of a guidance counselor approach, if you will, but not much.
Right.
Not much. There was still a little bit of you're in my space and you're not here because I wanted you to be here, but since you are here, I'm going to do what I need to do and be professionally courteous. And he was, and he tried a little bit, but there was not a lot of – I never got the feeling that anybody really wanted me there. Let's put it that way.
What are your thoughts on Schiavone's work as an announcer?
Different now than probably the way I felt then.
Right.
I felt back then that he was forced, a little too canned and not emotional enough. And when he pretended to be emotional, I felt like he was pretending to be emotional.
That's a good point. I've never heard it broken down like that, but I would tend to agree with you. I thought it was good in a certain dimension, but to your point, maybe lacking some of that emotion. In your book, you said he was an extremely hardworking guy.
Amazing.
In regards to what? Homework? Preparation?
Preparation, notes. He was a producer. He wasn't just an announcer. He was a producer. And there were a lot of different shows. There was probably two or three different syndicated shows going on at the time, a couple different cable shows going on at the time, you know, amalgamations of all of the above. And he was an announcer. So he worked like a dog.
Man, but we're right here and we're talking about the announcer thing. But what were your thoughts when you saw at the time when everybody knew Vince was going to try to take everything over and close down all the territories and go nationwide? You saw the writing on the wall, right?
No, that was really before
That was before I got involved with wrestling. Okay. That happened before I really got
that
to
was on time
AWA. Okay. Yeah, so I ended up getting into AWA because of
that. And that was on the back end. Was that really more or less on when AWA kind of started trending down?
Exactly.
Yeah, and that's kind of when I started getting that television, was kind of on the downside of it. I never really got a chance to see the AWA in its prime, which had a very good prime.
I did as a fan in Minneapolis.
But in South Texas, I didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think, Vern, going back in time, I mean, did he know what he had back in the day with the young Terry Bollea, Hulk Hogan?
I think he did. You know, and I talked, you know, Hulk and I are good friends, and we talk about things to this day. We talk about things like this. And I think, you know, Vern certainly knew there was a great talent there and wanted to exploit it. But Vern was also very stubborn and very close-minded and still had that old-school mentality, was only willing to give so much. So, sure, he knew he had something, but I think, you know, Vern's mistake, if Vern could go back and do things over again like we all wish we could, he would probably do that differently. But
yeah, you know, now that we went back to the AWA, when you were there doing your announcing, who were some of the talents that really stood out to you? Nick Bockwinkel was one of my favorites. I loved what he did. I loved his interview style as well, but I loved his ring work. Who did you really stood out to you back
to this day? To this day, and it, you know, it's hard because it's just, you know, you look. There's the time when I was there, and there's a time before I got there as a fan. You know, the time before I got there as a fan, Baron von Roschke, and even when I was there, because Baron and I used to travel to a couple of, you know, towns together and do live shows together. I love the Baron. You know, Ivan Putski. You know, the Russian Bear. But Nick Bockwinkel, Ray Stevens, who I got to know personally and did some pheasant hunting with. Wahoo McDaniel, but Nick Bockwinkel and Kurt Hennig, Larry the Axe, man, that's kind of tough to beat.
Yeah. So was Terry in Hulk when you were there?
No, I was a fan then.
Okay.
He had left by the time I got to AWA.
Okay, so then here we are back in WCW. Sorry, man. We'll start going back to those days and start thinking, okay, well, you were there, and let's ask a few questions about the talent that was in the ring. So, Shivani, Jim Ross ain't helping you a whole lot. And, man, I remember meeting you in a hallway there. You know, it was probably center stage, I guess. We just shook hands or something. I don't remember too much about it, but I remember meeting you because I was a fan when you was doing the stuff in AWA. How long were you there when all the stuff went down? And then you put in your bid to take over. 2 or 3 years? Because you called yourself a C-level announcer coming in.
CD.
Okay.
Maybe E.
Okay, in that range, you got the lead dogs doing their thing. Mm-hmm. And then how does that whole power structure start to change? And you see the vision.
You were there. You know, you and I spent a fair amount of time there together, although we were obviously in different kind of corners of the room for obvious reasons. You were a wrestler in the ring, and I was just doing what I was doing. But you know, you remember Kip Fry?
Yes.
Okay. What a disaster that was. And, you know, everybody's got different relationships with different people. But, you know, the Bill Watts thing was an ultra disaster.
God dang.
And what I saw from my perspective was that Turner, corporate, was tired of it. They tried the Jim Herd experiment. That didn't work. They tried a couple other variations of Jim Herd. They tried Kip Fry. That was a disaster. They tried all these different variations of management and leadership, and I knew that Turner Corporate, and I don't remember who told me, but I had gotten word that they were considering pulling the plug.
Right.
It was like, wait a minute, man, if they pull the plug, I'm going back to Minneapolis. I paid off a couple bills. I got about $40 in the bank, but this is going to be ugly again.
Right.
And I thought, you know what? I'm going to throw my name in the hat. And I had heard that they were looking for an executive producer, and they were so, you know, they tried the Bill Watts thing, and they wanted to get away from wrestling people. They wanted somebody to run the company that understood the entertainment business, but wasn't so entrenched in wrestling that they were sucked into the politics of it. So I just threw my name in a hat.
Man, what did your contemporaries? What did your peers there? What did when you
nobody
put your
knew.
Name in a hat? No, so it's kayfabe. Nobody knew.
Nobody knew.
Okay, but then you got serious consideration.
Yeah, it surprised the hell out of me. And it came on the heels. We were talking earlier about Jason and Hervey and I working together. It came on the heels of Jason and I creating this kids show, selling it to Fox. And I still, you know, I had all the, you know, work, you know, art boards and all the, you know, the props and stuff that I used to sell the show. And I brought it to Bill Shaw. And he said, okay, what would you do? And I set this stuff up and I pitched it the same way I pitched the kids show to Fox. And
obviously it struck a nerve.
When you were at AWA, you were selling a syndication. You was in the landscape business, and then you were selling some meat. You're a good salesman. You'd pay.
Used to be.
But I mean, these skills had to help you in your presentation.
I was passionate.
Yeah.
And I was clear. I felt it. I believed it. I believed in it. I believed in myself.
Right.
So yeah, it was easy to be a good. It's easy to be a good salesman when you're selling something that you believe in and you're passionate about. I didn't have any sales skill, but I could.
Yeah, I get you. I feel you.
And when I went in and I was passionate about wrestling, I always have been since I was a little kid.
Yeah.
And I was passionate about my approach to it
and
the solution that I had, especially given what Turner had already identified as their problem, which is we don't want any more wrestling guys running a television company.
Right.
So it worked.
So passion, but with the ability to sell.
The ability to sell. And I had a vision. I had a vision.
Okay, so what was the vision that you pitched that day in the office?
The vision I had was to broaden it because... I know the audience I'm speaking to, which is, you know, a broad audience, but if you go back in time, and this is what people fail to do sometimes, including myself, but if you go back in time and look at what WCW was and where it existed in that moment of time where I had this opportunity, it was considered a very small, third-rate, kind of southern. It had a little bit of the hereditary aspects of, you know, the NWA and the Crockett, you know, regional promotion.
Yeah.
And they were trying to compete with the WWF at the time, WWE.
Right.
So I knew that, okay, if you want to compete at their level, you have to be able to play at that level.
Right.
You can't play down here and expect to compete up here. So my approach was to mainstream it and to make it feel bigger, and to make it feel more mainstream and less regional.
Make it feel less regional. Hmm. I'm sitting here talking with Eric Bischoff. I was in here talking to Eric Bischoff. We're drinking Buffalo Bill Cody beer. We're about an hour and 3 minutes in. And you talk about a cliffhanger. The old Republic pitchers couldn't have left off at a better place than this. I'm stopping this conversation right here, right now. You'll come back Thursday's edition, Unleashed. Everything remains the same. We might throw a few words in there, but we're talking Eric Bischoff. We're talking about his rise to the ranks of professional wrestling. We're talking about Buffalo Bill Cody beer. We're talking about life hunting and all kinds of BS. It's a good time here at 316 Gimmick Street. Tune in Thursday for the rest of the show. You're going to dig it the most. All right, gang, we're going to continue on in here in a minute, but I got to give a little love to my sponsors. That includes Onnit, the company that makes the greatest supplements on planet Earth. They're the ones making my alpha brain. I take it every morning. It's a supplement that keeps me focused and razor sharp. The one that lets me open two cans of audio whoop ass for you each and every single week. But Onnit also makes tons of other great supplements. And if you go to Onnit.com/Steve right now, you'll get 10% off your order. Onnit's got Shroom Tech Sport. Yeah, it will take your workout to a whole nother level. And if you're over 25 years of age, then you definitely need to pick up Onnit's T+. It's the best all-natural way to boost your testosterone. And I don't care what you say. Every guy over the age of 25 needs to boost their testosterone. It's just a fact of life, people. And you're going to have more energy and motivation than you can check a stick at. And if it don't happen like that, you can get all your money back, no questions asked. Money back guarantee up in this mug. So go to Onnit.com/Steve to get your 10% discount off all your supplements. What are you waiting for? Go now. That's Onnit.com. Onnit.com/Steve to get 10% off your order. Well, all right, folks, that's going to wrap up my conversation right here on Tuesday's show, Steve Austin Show. We're going to hit the stop button. We're going to pick it up on Thursday and continue with Eric Bischoff.
This has been a Podcast One production. Download new episodes of The Steve Austin Show every Tuesday at podcastone.com. That's podcastone.com.
Support for this podcast comes from Pluto TV. Need an escape? Drop into Pluto TV for a world of free TV. Stream hundreds of channels and thousands of movies and shows all for free. Yeah, free. No subscriptions, no fees. Imagine 24/7 channels of Narcos, CSI, Star Trek, Survivor, and everything else from hit movies to binge-worthy TV shows, the latest news, live sports, comedy, and more. What are you waiting for? Download the free Pluto TV app for Android, iPhone, Roku, and Fire TV and start streaming now. Pluto TV. Drop in, watch free.
All right, sports fans, Podcast One has two great new shows for you to check out. Seven-time NBA champ Robert Horry is bringing big guests and great NBA commentary on the Big Shot Bob Pod.
The Brooklyn Nets remind me of Oklahoma Sooner football. And we got to have to outscore you every time. And that's what the Brooklyn Nets are.
Man, you got Steve Nash at the helm. You got D'Antoni. They ain't thinking about no defense.
And Eric Bolling and Brett Favre come together for Bowling with Favre. Everything from sports to politics to business and culture.
Any insight on what Aaron plans to do in Green Bay?
What I read into his comments were simply frustration. Nothing more than that.
Subscribe now to the Big Shot Bob Pod and Bowling with Favre on the Podcast One app, Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. And rate and review the shows on Apple for your chance to be featured.